adjusted configuration a little bit to make it better so that people can be right in front and bring everybody a little closer. Let's stand on our feet. We want to welcome you watching over the internet as well. For the next 19 minutes, you'll be with us here at BCF Church in Brampton, Ontario. We're going to be worshiping the Lord. We've got our children with us this summer, and so we're going to be incorporating them in the service. Let's lift our hands to worship the Lord. Father, we thank you today that you brought us to be able to worship you. We just want to honor you with all that is within us. We love you, and we know you love us. So, Lord, we come to receive all you have for us. But, Lord, we want to sing and worship you with all of our heart. Receive our praise. Inhabit our praises. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Welcome to a place where rejoicing reigns, 'cause our God is great and greatly to be praised. We can tell it all around.
You have to be
aware. Tell it all around that it's going down, 'cause our God is great and greatly to be praised. Lift your voice and sing if you've been redeemed, 'cause our God is great and greatly to be praised. If he brought you out, if he brought you out, lift your voice and shout, 'cause our God is great, 'cause our God is great and greatly to be praised. Above all names, the one who reigns forever, still the same, praise the name. And no other name that's higher, no other name that's stronger, no other name, forever I will praise the name. No other name can name above all names, the one who reigns forever. Till the saved, praise the name, Jesus.
Jesus Christ is Lord. Let's sing every nation.
Every nation, all creation, we proclaim your name. Every nation.
Our God, amen. There's no one like our God. He's always for us. He's fighting for us, and he'll never leave us, amen. And he makes us brave this morning. Let us sing that.
I stand before you now.
the greatness of your renown. I have heard of the majesty and wonder of you, King of heaven. In humility I bow as your love in wave after wave crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us, you are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in. Oh, you made a way for us, Jesus. Let's sing about He's calling us. I heard you call. I've heard you calling my name. I've heard the song of love. I have heard the song of love that you sing. Oh, so I will let you draw me out beyond the shore into your grace.
Sing it out. You make me brave.
fighting for us. You are right by our side and you never leave us, Lord. No one like you, Jesus. No one like you. Just call on his name. He's right beside you.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us, kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say,
oh, never was,
never was, did we ever walk alone,
never was,
did you leave us on our own.
You are faithful, God,
you are faithful, God,
you are,
and
every step, let's sing, kneeling on this battleground.
Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say, never was, never.
sing that again. Oh, what can I say?
To you,
let's sing. You stood.
You stood before.
your praise, oh Lord. Oh, we bless your name, oh Lord. Lord, we bless your name, oh Lord. Oh, we give you praise. Oh, we bless your name, oh Lord. Oh, we give you praise. We bless your name in the house today, Lord. Oh, we bless your name, oh Lord. I stand, oh Lord. Oh Lord, when I don't know what to do, I stand, oh Lord. I stand in your presence, oh Lord. Oh, we give you praise, oh Lord. Oh, we bless your name, Lord. We bless your name. We glorify your name, oh Lord. We stand in your presence, Lord. Our hearts are abandoned unto you, Lord. All my motives, all my objectives, oh Lord, are abandoned unto you, oh Lord. Oh, I bless your name, oh Lord. Oh, we give you praise. You know, the Psalms, in Psalms 91, it said, if we make the Lord our dwelling place, even the Most High our refuge, then no evil shall befall you. Even if it comes, it will not affect you, because we are dwelling in the presence of God. And he promises that he will give his angels charge over you, oh Lord, to keep you in all of his ways, because I am dwelling in the presence of God. That's what worship does for us. Worship takes us so we dwell in the presence of God, so he can give his angels charge over me. So that's why we can sing this morning, oh God, I'm going to stand in your presence. Oh God, I'm going to stand in your care. Oh God, I'm going to stand so in your watchful eyes, oh Lord, because I know, oh God, that nowhere that I go that you can't see me, oh Lord. Nothing comes to you, oh God, unnoticed to you, oh Lord. So God, I'm going to stand in your presence. I'm going to stand in your presence, oh God. I'm standing in your presence, oh God, because in your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand, oh God, there are pleasures forevermore. All I need, oh God, is in you. All that I need, oh God, is in you, oh God. Oh, and bless your name, oh Lord. Oh, we give you praise. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Would you bow your head with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you, oh Lord. We thank you, oh God, that we can come today with boldness and say, oh God, that you are my Savior. Lord, you are my source. You are my strength, oh God. All that I need is in you, oh Lord. So, oh God, I'm standing in your presence. I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I give you my eyes. I give you my hands, my feet, oh God. That you will live in me and through me, oh God, that you will be glorified in everything that I see, everything that I say, in everything that I do. Glorify yourself in us and through us, oh Lord. We bless your name, we praise you and thank you. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. It is finished. God loves you. Do you know that God loved you with an everlasting love? That's why you're here today. You didn't come because you wanted to come to church. You came because the Spirit of God drew you here. And God has something for each and every one of us today. And it is so good for me to welcome everyone here. If this is your first time at BCF, thank you for choosing BCF. If you're watching via the internet, thank you as well for choosing BCF. Interact with us during the service. We want to hear from you. We want to hear your prayer requests. We want to hear your testimony, what God is doing in your life, because we want to join our faith with you and believe God for what he's doing in your life. And we're going to take an opportunity and we're going to greet each other. But the children are here, the junior high and the children department is there, but the nursery is open, ready to receive your dear babies. So please register them. But before we do that, Pastor Randy and Pastor Jill celebrated their 47th anniversary today. So we want to pray for them as well. They are our spiritual leaders that God has installed in the church. So we want to believe God. We want to join our faith for them. Why don't you stretch your hand forward? So Father, we thank you for the leadership you have installed in BCF. We thank you for your spiritual authority, Lord, the divine authority that you've placed on them. So, Father, we thank you for strengthening them. We thank you for your wisdom in them. We thank you for health and the strength in their body. I thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing in their life and in their family. So, Father, we bless your name, we praise you, and thank you for their example. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to greet each other at this time, and we're going to express God's love as you do that. Thank you.
I continue to ask that you join us in this song as well as you greet one another. Kids, you're more than welcome to stand up to your feet, spread on out. We're going to sing that God is here and that he is real. Joan.
Woo! Jump! That was fun. Bless God. Well, welcome again. It's so good to see everyone this morning, today. Hope you're having a great time. It's good to be together. Well, when you came in today, you should have received a package, an information package that looks like this. If you want to go ahead and take that out, that would be great. And if you did not receive a package, our ushers are happy and ready to serve you. They'll have a pen if you need one of those as well. Everybody's got one? Does anybody not have one? Raise your hands if you don't have one. So we got a couple in the front there. Glasses. Well, I want to welcome those that are first-time guests with us today. If you're a first-time guest, if you would go ahead and take out what, from your information package, what we call our connection card. It looks like this. Everybody got one? If you want to take that out, grab your pen. If you're a first-time guest, please tick that off on the front. Fill out your full name and your email. Print clearly. We want to stay connected with you. And then at the end of the service, if you would go over to our welcome area and visit with our pastors and some of our leaders there, they just want to get to know you by name. And there's a special gift for you. How many like gifts? Great. Well, our first-time guests, you get a gift. So bring your connection card, your completed connection card, over to the welcome area, which is just on your left. Okay, and then for those of you that are second-time guests, if you would indicate that as well in our regular tenders, that would be great if you would do that also. So it's time for us to worship God. Again, we're going to continue. We had fun worshiping God, dancing and singing and praising his name. Well, we want to honor him with the first of our increase, with our giving. He created us to be givers. You know why? Because he's a giver. He gave his best. He gave his son for us, and he's put that giving in us, and the Holy Spirit helps us with that. But we have to put an action with it as well. Okay, thanks, Pastor Randy. So it may require a little bit of bravery to do that. I know for things that I don't want to do, and I'm trying to train myself to do, I've got to do something I don't want to do to get where I want to get to. Did that make sense? Okay, good. I hope it did. Well, this is the same with our giving as well. We want to be brave and courageous and fearless and strong in our giving and our expressing our love to God. So here is your opportunity. I just want to read this to you from Ephesians 3:14. And this is Paul speaking. He said, my response is to get down on my knees before the Father, the magnificent Father who parcels out all heaven and earth. So God parcels out everything, and ask him to strengthen me by his Spirit. And his Spirit is living on the inside of every believer. He's living on the inside of me and you as well. Not a brute strength, but a glorious inner strength that Christ will live in you as you open the door and invite him in. And ask him that with both feet planted firmly on love, you will be able to take in with all followers of Jesus Christ the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience the breadth. Test the length. Plumb to the depth, rise to the heights, live full lives, full in the fullness of God. That's the blessings of God, and it's a choice that we make. We're going to make that choice together today. So if you have your offering envelopes, if you haven't completed that, you can take a few minutes in doing that. We have giving kiosks in the foyer. You can give online. I did it already. So you can give online with your phone. You can go to www.bcfchurch.net. and select donate, and then donate again and give that way. We have great opportunities, and for those of you watching online, you're able to do the same thing as well. So let our team just play for you while you're completing that. Offerings together, tithes and offerings. Father, we thank you that you are a great giver. You are amazing. You are wonderful. You are our Father. And we praise you and we choose to worship you today in our finances. We thank you that you've given to us so that we can give to you and that you would bless it, Father, and you'd rebuke the devourer in every single way. So bless those that have given, Father. Thank you for your presence in their lives. And for those that may not think that they have something to give, thank you that you're touching their hearts even now. So, Father, we commit this into your hands. And we thank you for doing more than we could ask, imagine, or think, because you're the God of infinite resources. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Our ushers would come and receive our giving. Are on. The kids have been here through the week and they're continuing through the rest of the month of July, and there's a few more camps as well. There is a great information table in the foyer. Parents, friends that are here, please visit the table and register your kids. And I think there's some really cool pictures from the camp that they were at last week. I like pictures. They were really good. Then one more thing, on Tuesday night we have family night at Gage Park. And our kids are going to be there with their families. Why don't you come out and join them? Bring a friend or a neighbor with you as well. 7 o'clock at Gage Park downtown. Let's welcome Pastor Angie and Jill.
Great to see you all today. Turn and smile at your neighbor. Pretend you're happy. Good. I saw some of you up dancing in the aisles. That's good. It's good to do that. It's just, to me, it's a blessing to be able to be together like this with family. Thank you for your well wishes. We're still happily married after 47 years, right?
Good. Depends if I get to talk today. No, just kidding.
Right. We want to pray before we get going with other things. I really want to pray for a few people. Violet, just wave at me. I hear your sister passed into glory today. And so just at 5 a.m. this morning, sister in Jamaica passed. And so we want to pray for her, pray for family. There are others still in the hospital. And there may be some even here today that are not well, or maybe over the internet. You're not well today. We want to join our faith with you. The Bible talks about healing. Talks about actually caring for people and being our comforter. That's the Holy Spirit. So, Father, we pray right now,
Jesus,
that you would bring your health and your strength,
yes,
to those,
Father,
that need it. Lord, whether it's Janelle in the hospital or many others, Jesus, that are sick at home and other places,
Jesus,
we pray for your strength, especially for those that are older, Father.
Yes,
we pray for
Lord,
your strength to rise,
Jesus,
up inside of them. Let the joy,
Jesus,
of the Lord be their strength day by day.
Yes,
help the Morgans, Lord, as they serve you with gladness where they are. And many of our other friends, Lord, just continue to strengthen them and let your word dwell richly in them. Be with Violet and her family as they have taken the loss of a sister that's gone. And so, Lord, I pray that you would comfort them, encourage them, help them to know where she is and not to have sorrow take over their lives as is custom of some, but no, rather to rejoice that she's with her Lord and Savior. So, Lord, strengthen us today and focus our attention. We pray to receive everything you have for us,
Jesus,
in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Coming soon is lots of people traveling. And where is she? There you are. Casey is going to be heading out in about a week and a half, I guess, right, to Armenia and the
Georgia.
Country of Georgia. You know where that is? Over the other side of the Black Sea. And being there on a music team that's traveling and ministering the gospel in that area. So pray for her. Who else is traveling over the next couple of weeks? We're going to be gone for 2 weeks in Dominican. And we just want to pray. Just stand up where you are. I know there's many traveling. Ruel's heading to Philippines and others are traveling various places. We want to pray for you, and we want to believe this. Just catch my attention. We want to believe this. I want to believe that as you travel, you go with purpose, and you go with a message in your heart to be able to be light to those you interact with, salt, to bring seasoning of God there, and that we will pray for safety for you, but go with purpose, and share Jesus wherever you are. So just pray for those ones, Jill.
Father, we just thank you for the privilege that you give us to travel and to touch other people's lives. So, Father, whether we're on vacation or whether we're going for work or for a specific purpose with family or others, Father, we thank you. Your presence is always with us. You never leave us or forsake us. But, Father, help us to be sensitive to your voice so we speak the things you'd have us speak and say the things at the right time that would touch people's hearts for your kingdom. So we thank you for these ones that are standing and for others that are going or even gone this past week. We thank you that your protection will be upon them, that you will be with them and bring them back safely, rejoicing in you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good to see Brenda Arthur as well. Did she slip out with a baby? Okay. Brenda's been gone for almost forever. Right, Angus? Seen that way. From April in the Philippines, training as a midwife. So if you need midwifery services, we have people around. Not in the service this morning, but other times. Dominican Republic, tell us about what's happening there, please.
Well, it's getting to be a very exciting time. And we want to thank all of you that have been praying and helping us and many doing different things to support us. And as many of you know, 2 years ago we went to Honduras, and this year we are going to Dominican Republic. And together we have a team that has taken a step of faith. Their first step of faith was to register. Then they started to believe God for jobs and finances so that they could pay for their trip. And this year it was a little more challenging because, as you know, the Canadian dollar kept dropping and we were paying US dollars. So the price of our trip kept escalating. But I am so proud of the team we have here at BCF Church, as they didn't get all upset, but they continued to stay in faith as God continued to bless them. And we have our team strong, and they're ready to go. And in 4 short days, we will be leaving for Miami, where we will meet 2,000 other missionaries, and we will spend the day together. And then first thing Sunday morning sometime, we will be getting on charter flights, and together 2,000 missionaries will descend upon the Dominican Republic. Amen. Those missionaries are coming from as far away as Australia. There's teams from Africa coming, from the West Coast of the United States, from Alaska, and Canada. Woo-hoo. And so we're excited. And I can just imagine how excited heaven is right now, yes, about what this team is going to do and Amen. Accomplish. Amen. So we're so grateful to the president of Dominican Republic, that even that he opened his heart to allow us to come and to take over his nation. You see, he knows his nation needs change. He's not sure how to bring that change. Some of the things they've been doing haven't been working, just like in many of our countries. But he has allowed us to come. And so 2,000 missionaries will be in every state. We are going to the state of Santa Maria, Trinidad, if you want to look it up on the map. We will be traveling out of the city of Nagua. And we are so grateful that God ordained everything ahead of time. Because you see, when God ordains your footsteps, he sets you up for success. And as God ordained our footsteps, he brought Jim and Merrill DeWeerd to our congregation. They raised a wonderful son who is a missionary in Dominican Republic. He just happens to be living in the city of Nagua. And he has been working very hard with the pastors there on our behalf. And so we are so grateful to God that when he says, I have a good plan for your life, it's a plan with a future and a hope. And that he doesn't just say it, but he actually performs his word, so that we can walk in it. So I'd like to invite the team that's here today. I know some were in the first service, but whoever's here, come on up.
Put your hands together, please, for them. Praise God. It's our one nation flag.
We are one nation, one day. Can a nation be turned in a day, the Bible says. And we resound together and say, yes, it can, with kingdom of God. And so our shirts here, they say, change yourself, change a nation. And so we have gathered together. Nice shirt. Thank you. I know. He didn't get his shirt. But we'll let him come anyway. But we have our team here. And, you know, I was just looking at God's word. And I've got to hurry because he wants to preach. In 1 Chronicles 16:23, it says, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all his people. In Matthew chapter 28, Jesus had just risen from the dead. And the first time he met with his disciples. And I want to declare this over each and every one of you. As he came to meet with his disciples, and they gathered there in Galilee. If you want to see Galilee, you can come with us in February. Jesus came and he told his disciples, I have given all authority in heaven and earth to you, my disciples. So because I have given you all the authority of heaven, you go and you make disciples of every nation and you teach them to be my disciple and follow after me. But he doesn't stop there. He says, as you do that, you can be sure of this one thing. I am with you always. So you don't have to worry about, will I say the right thing? Will I do the right thing? The presence of God is with you. So today at BCF Church, I have the privilege of commissioning you, a soon-to-be doctor, as a missionary for Jesus Christ, as a student. I'm not sure what you are. Are you a legal, paralegal? Are you a paralegal? I tell you, as a children's pastor, worker, whatever you, I don't know what your title is. A student and guitar player, soon to be marvelous worship leader. Yes. A mom that works and looks after her children. I tell you, we've got everything. So today, congregation, would you please stand?
Yeah.
And we want Pastor to pray. And we want to commission these young people, some of us that are a little more mature, as missionaries for the kingdom of God to change a nation as God is changing us.
Just stretch your hands out towards them. Father, we release a blessing upon these ones.
Jesus.
Keep them safe as they travel.
Jesus.
But Lord, we pray for the
Jesus.
Anointing of God that is already
Jesus.
Within them.
Yes,
to
Father.
Rise up
yes,
strong.
Jesus.
Father, that
Jesus.
The word of God pours forth from them, from their lives, from their actions, from their words. Lord, empower them for service now. We commission them unto you as mighty servants of God to bring about change in lives. The anointing of God flows through them. The power of God is released upon them. Lord, for you working. Divine appointments, Lord, for you working within them. Yes, Father, open their eyes to their future. Let them see your hand upon them. Help them, Lord Jesus, to receive all that you have for them and to pour themselves out in that nation. Lord, that you get all the glory and honor in Jesus' name. We pray for the president of the Dominican Republic, for Danilo Medina. We pray for him and all the government leaders now. Lord, that you would open their hearts as well in every city, in every village, in every state, Lord, that you'd open their hearts to the gospel of Jesus Christ, but to people who care for them, that there be a mighty outpouring of the Spirit of God over that nation, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
So this is just a part of the team. We have 25 from BCF Church. Our team for Canada will be 77 people, and they will be going out every day. They will be going to 4 or 5 sites a day, sharing the gospel of Jesus. When we went to Honduras, they went to schools, so the crowd was already gathered. But this year, they will be in parks on the streets, and they will have to gather their own crowd. But you see, as we were singing today, we are brave, and Jesus is with us.
Amen.
We are not alone.
Yes.
So we are asking you to pray for us and believe God that the people will come. While they're there, they'll be giving out shoes. Skechers has been so generous to donate shoes for the Dominican Republic. So we will be giving out shoes. Our Canadian team has been able to raise some finances. And we are building 4 houses in our state for people that just have a great need for proper place to live. So God is using our team greatly. So continue to pray for us and remember us while we're there. That God will do great things amongst our young people, that they will never be the same because they are marked by the presence of God.
Amen. You guys can be seated. Thank you so much. Put your hands together for them, please. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father. Well, excellent. In the package you received when you came in is a little thing like this, a little sheet like that. Would you pull it out, please? This is to help me. We're just in... planning for a great fall, and so we're looking at getting some input from you just on very practical things, how long you've been part of BCF Church, what do you believe are some spiritual disciplines that are important to Christians. So what would be a spiritual discipline that you would have? Could be Bible reading, could be prayer. I'm asking every person to fill it out, please, okay? So I'm looking across to see your obedience. Yeah, thank you. Just pull it out of the file and fill it out for us, and we'll put it in the connection card buckets on the way out, please. And then what areas of the church are you involved with, and then just your age. And so just four simple questions. We want to try to help us just to focus for the future and what God is doing. So we're in a series called Brave. And that's what we're talking about, isn't it? If you were here last week, you remember we talked about a man named David. Who said that? Okay. Right here, Kayla. Oh, sorry, badge thrower. Okay, good. Kayla. No, David. Okay, good. And so David then taught us four quick lessons, and I'm going to move swiftly with us this morning. He talked about how we should obey our parents, obey our leaders, and fulfill the responsibilities given to us. David did that, didn't he? He did it as a shepherd, and then he did it as a leader over an army, and he did it as a king. And so we can do that in our area. If you're a student, then it's obeying your parents and your teachers and those over us. If we're in a workplace, it's recognizing that the boss is somebody that God has put in place over you. If you don't think he's godly, then pray for him or her and watch God work there. And then that we're to stand up for what's right, even when those around us will not. So we always want to remember that lesson and to carry it in our heart and do it every day. And then go against the opinion of others. Some people like to speak against authority. They like to speak against the boss. They like to complain. They like to have pastor for Sunday dinner after service. And so don't do that. Do be like David and instead speak words of life. Don't fight against any of God's chosen authority, regardless of whether it's in government or wherever it is. And then finally, if you sin, and I'm not encouraging you to do this, just to test it out, but if you find yourself in sin, quickly admit your sin. Don't hide. Don't fake it and figure nobody's going to find out. God knows already. So instead, humble yourself and admit it, and then ask God to forgive you. And then turn around from your sin and don't go back there anymore. And David taught us that lesson even in the Psalm 51, create in me a clean heart, O Lord. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Because see, David understood something, that when you sin, you separate yourself from God. You step away from him, and his presence with you is diminished. And so don't live that way. So David taught us many things, didn't he? And today we're going to go into our next Bible, a character who was very brave. And his name was Noah. How many have heard of Noah before? Noah and the Arky. Okay, Noah and the Ark. It's found in Genesis chapter 6. So if you want to turn in your Bible or turn on your Bible, Genesis chapter 6, we're going to start reading around verse 5. I'm going to read a number of verses, and our children are going to help us again today. So if you've got children there, there's probably a place for them. I hope when they came in, they got one of the coloring sheets or activity sheets, because when they bring them back completed, they get a gift just like this. How many think that's a good idea? Good. Okay, Dolores, you get one. Thank you so much. Oh, sorry, I'm a poor thrower today. Genesis 6, verse 5. Got it? The Lord observed the extent of human wickedness on the earth, and he saw that everything they thought or imagined was consistently and totally evil. So the Lord was sorry. Listen, the Lord was sorry that he'd ever made them and put them on the earth. It broke his heart. So, and the Lord said, I will wipe this human race that I've created from the face of the earth. Yes, I will destroy every living thing, all the people, all the large animals, the small animals that scurry along the ground, even the birds of the sky. I'm sorry that I made them. And then there's that special word, but. But Noah found favor with God. And verse 9 is our memory verse. This is the account of Noah and his family. Listen to this. Noah was righteous, was a righteous man, the only blameless person. Hey, man. What's your name? Noah. Shout it out. Say Noah.
Noah.
What?
Noah.
Noah, not Yessa. Noah. Okay, so this is Noah. And he was a righteous man, the only blameless man living at the time. And he walked close in close fellowship with God. You spent time with God every day? Wow, that's fantastic. And Noah was the father of three sons. There was there was Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Look at these guys. Don't they look like nice boys? Praise the Lord. Who's Shem? Which guy's Shem? Is that you? You must be Shem. You're the tallest one there. All right. So Shem is there. Isn't he a handsome young man? Don't you think? Come on now. We need a little audience participation now. Put it up for Shem. And you're the Ham? Oh, you're the Ham. Okay, this is Ham. And there's the Japheth guy in the middle. Praise God. Nice looking boys you've got there. Fantastic. Now, let me read a little bit further. In Genesis chapter 6:11, it says, now God saw the earth had become corrupt and was filled with violence. I mean, God observed all this corruption in the world, for everyone on earth was corrupt. And let me see what else. So God said to Noah, where's my wicked people? You missed your cue, guys. They're partying. Okay, they're partying. Okay, good. So here they are partying, making lots of noise. Yes, wow. They're partying. And when they get partying, sometimes they get bad. That's right. And they start fighting with each other. And they what are you throwing? Okay, they're throwing ping pong balls around and everything. How wicked can you get? Here they are, and they're very wicked. And God said some things then. God said, I've decided to destroy all these. He's talking to you now. God said, I've decided to destroy all the living creatures, for they filled the earth with violence. Yes, I will wipe them out all along the earth. Build a large boat of cypress wood. He said gopher wood. Do you know what a gopher is? No, that's why he called it cypress. All right, do you know what a boat is? All right, good, good. And I want you to make this this large boat, waterproof it with tar inside and out, then construct decks and stalls through all its interior. Doesn't that sound like fun? I want you to make it 450 feet long. Does that sound good? Easy, right? Okay. 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet high. Leave an opening 18 inches below the roof all the way around the boat. Put the door on the side and build three decks inside the boat, a lower deck, a middle deck, and an upper deck. Got that? How many decks? Three, and what do we call them? Lower, middle, and upper. Got it, okay? Upper, look, I'm about to cover the earth with a flood that will destroy every living thing that breathes. Everything on earth will die. Is that good or bad? Pretty bad, yeah. Okay, it's bad. And so everything on earth will die, but I will confirm my covenant with you. Good boy. Yes, so enter the boat, you and your wife and your sons and your wives. Bring a pair of every kind of animal, male and female, into the boat that will keep them alive during the flood. Pairs of every kind of animal and every kind of bird and every kind of animal, every kind of small animal that scurries along the ground will come to you to be kept alive. And be sure you take enough food for all your family and for the animals. Does that sound like a good idea? That's a lot of food. And Noah, listen to this. So Noah did everything exactly as God commanded him. So start to build the ark. All right, we need extra help. Noah's dad, grandfather's here. Praise the Lord. So here we go. Now, Noah was coming up to 600 years of age at the time, and he's getting there, and they're getting ready to build the ark, and so I'm sure you'll be able to hear them hammering in a little while and sawing and making lots of noise as they do that, busy building the ark. Now imagine the size of the ark. Praise the Lord. Hashem is the hardest worker, of course. And so imagine, how big was that? Well, if you go across from the back wall to this stage, to this backstage here, do you know how long that is? That's 75 feet. So that's as wide as the ark is from this ark all the way to the clothesline, not clothesline, from this place here all the way to the back wall. That's how wide it is. And how tall is 45 feet? It's twice as high as the ceiling. See where the fluorescent lights are at the ceiling? That's about half of 45 feet. So it's twice as high as this, and there's three decks in this. And then how long is it? Well, if you started walking at this wall back here and you kept walking, you would walk just across the street between here and Walmart where their parking lot starts, and that's 450 feet. Now, they didn't use feet then. They used cubits. And so a cubit was a measurement from your elbow to the top of your finger, about 20 inches, half a meter long. And so it was to be 150 cubits long. That is a big boat. Is that true? Big boat. In fact, some people have compared it. Oh, here, what's happened? They're building the ark and the scoffers are here. Look at all these scoffers fighting against it, saying, oh, how silly you are. Wow. Guys, I think you need to build faster. Keep building. Even though there's scoffers there, they didn't stop. They just kept right on building. And they did exactly what God said. They built it. I think we have a picture of an ark we can put up on the screen. And so they actually built this ark. They built a full scale, same size, same dimensions, built an ark in the Netherlands, and opened it for public viewing in 2012. That was a believer that did that. So now if you want to pay 12 and a half euros and fly over there, you can see the actual size. It's got three decks on it. It's got animals, but they're not live because they didn't want to feed them all the time. So or shovel it out. And so that it's the animals are there, though, so you can get a real picture of what it looks like. And then Genesis chapter 7 is where they're getting close to having everything ready. Now, you can imagine, how long would it take to build an ark like that? That is a huge vessel that they're building. And guess what? They had no power tools. There was no extension cord to run. All they had was hammers and a saw and probably an axe type of thing as well. And that's what God used, helped these four workers to do that. Praise God. He almost got it done. Praise the Lord. That's a pretty wicked looking ark, I must say. All right, let's go to chapter 7, verse 1. When everything was ready, the Lord said to Noah, go into the boat with all your family. Where's your family? Where's your wives? Yeah. Do you have a wife? No. You do so, man. You forgot. You've got a wife. Okay. Praise the Lord. Where's the wife? There's a wife. Okay, good. Beautiful wife. Where's another? We got four wives. We need four wives up here. Four. Well, we have one. We have four guys. We need four ladies too, don't we? All right. How many do we have so far? Is this the fourth one? Is there eight of them then? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Congratulations, ladies. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Okay. So there they are. There's our team. They've already built the boat. Get into all the boat, he says, and take with you seven pairs, male and female, of each animal that I've approved for eating and for sacrifice, and take one pair of each of the other animals. So God is bringing animals. They're coming. Look at the animals coming now onto the stage. What kind of animals are these ones? Oh, they're horse. What are you? What are you? A horsey. He looks like a zebra. Yeah, okay, great. We have horses, and we have, what do we have over here? Giraffes, yes, you're tall as a giraffe, and we have dogs, okay, woof, woof, and we have, what are you guys? Tigers, fantastic, and what are these guys? Pigs, oink, oink, okay, so we have pigs. Aren't you glad that the skunks didn't come first? We're not sure if everybody else would show up. So we're just going to imagine that all of the animals are there. I was hoping Pastor Reed would come with his trunk and be an elephant, but he didn't. So we'll just go on and read more. And then so all of them came, it says. And then in verse 11 of chapter 7, it says, when Noah was 600 years of age, on the 17th day of the second month, all the underground water started to erupt. Listen, they'd never had rain before. Just dew had fallen on the ground. That's how the crops grew. But now all the underground water came. And then it says that that even rain fell in mighty torrents from the sky. And the rain continued for 40 days. And for 40 nights, the rain was pouring down upon the people, crying out, get your ponchos, get your rain ponchos. I see they're selling ponchos here as well as the rain is falling down. Get the ponchos, get your ponchos. All right. The rain is falling down. Hallelujah. And God wiped out every living thing on earth. The people, the livestock, small animals, all the birds, all were destroyed. The only people who survived were Noah. Where's Noah? Noah, where's your wife? Down. Okay, never mind. She's still on the ark with him. Maybe she's sweeping up the animals. And there she was. Only people were Noah and those on the boat. Now, when Noah now was 601 years of age, you look pretty good for 601, I must say. And on the first day of the new year, 10 and a half months after the flood began, the floodwaters had almost dried up from the earth. Noah lifted back the covering of the boat. Okay, we'll just pretend you did that. Lifted back the covering of the boat, and he saw the surface of the ground was drying. 2 more months went by, and at last, the earth was dry. Listen to this. Can you imagine yourself in a boat with all of those animals for a whole year? It would be very exciting. And there they were, and God said to Noah, verse 15 and verse 16, leave the boat, all of you, you and your wife and your sons and your wives, leave the boat. And all of the animals, leave the boat. You can go as well. All the small animals, where the horses are galloping out. The pigs are kind of moving slow. There goes Japheth looking for his wife again. Praise God, off the stage. Let's put our hands together and thank the children. Thank you, guys. Praise God. Well, did you get the picture? God used Noah, didn't he? And so what lessons can we get off of this? Well, in Luke chapter 17, verse 26, 27, New Testament now. Luke chapter 17, 26, 27, says, when the Son of Man returns, it will be like it was in Noah's day. In those days, the people enjoyed banquets and partying and weddings right up until the time Noah entered the boat and the flood came and destroyed them all. This is the day we're living in. It's the last days. And in the last days, people are busy with life, busy working, busy enjoying themselves, just doing whatever they're going to do. But judgment is on its way. Why? Because there's sin on planet Earth. Everyone who has not called on the name of the Lord Jesus for salvation is under the judgment of Almighty God. There's violence around the world, even violence in our calm city of Brampton. You hear about it all the time. God is ready to judge the earth, to judge the people. But he promised Noah that he would never judge the same way and destroy everyone. And he put a rainbow up above as Noah offered a sacrifice. And the rainbow in the sky is to be a sign of the covenant between God and man that he will never, ever destroy all humanity again. Isn't that good? Now, we understand that the rainbow's been perverted to mean something else. But God said, no, this is a sign in the skies, a sign in the clouds, that I will never again judge the way that I have, but God still will judge. And so let me give you 4 quick lessons. Lesson number 1, God will judge sin and sinners. You see, God is not just filled with love. Many people think, oh, God is love, so how could he ever judge? How could he ever send anyone to hell? How could he ever separate himself from all of humanity or from people that he loves, that he actually created? But you see, just as much as God is love, God is just. He is a just father, a just judge. And so consequently, if people sin, his justice must be satisfied, and God must judge sin and must judge humanity. It's not an option, or he would not be God. He would be going against who he is as a just God. So God wants us to understand that. But we say often, well, I went and I did this. I saw my neighbor do this. I saw my friend do that. And they didn't get judged. I mean, no lightning bolt came out of heaven and zapped them. So maybe it's just a story. No, God does not work on our timetable. God works on his timetable. And there will be a day of reckoning. In fact, in the Bible itself, in the 20th chapter of the book of Revelation, it talks about a white throne judgment where all of humanity will that have never surrendered their life to Jesus will stand before Almighty God. And they will have to give an account of what they did with Jesus. Did they surrender their will, surrender their lives, and serve Jesus? Or did they decide by not doing that, voluntarily, they're defaulted back to being separate from God forever? You see, there's only one. You're either in the kingdom of God or you're out of the kingdom of God. If you have the Son, if you accept God through his Son, Jesus, you have life eternal. If you've not done that, the Bible clearly says you do not have life. Doesn't matter if you come to church every Sunday. It's about what we do with Jesus Christ. Would it be said of you, there's a righteous man, there's a righteous woman that follows after God, pursues after God. So God wants us to know, lesson number one, that there will be a final judgment. Sin will be judged. It's all right for you to carry that message, not to condemn people, but to wake them up sometimes that there will be a reckoning in the future. Lesson number two, God looks for brave people who will live righteous in a sinful time. We live in a sinful generation. So how should we live as followers of Jesus Christ? We should live in a right way from God's standard, not the world's around us standard, but from God's standard. We should do what God says do, spend time with him, have a relationship with him. You see, even before Jesus Christ, Noah had a relationship with God. It says he walked with God. He spent time with God. He had an intimacy of relationship with God. That's what God wants. It's not about coming to a church building. It's not about praying a prayer. It's about having a relationship with a living God. Amen? I don't mind you talking to me today. God helps us. And so we need to be brave and to live righteously in this generation as well. So I believe this. I believe that God always has a remnant of people, a leftover of people, a set aside people that are living for him and pleasing him all the time. I believe that there's a people like that today. Do you believe that? I believe that there's many here that are in that category. Wake up your neighbor. Tell them that's you. You're one of those righteous ones. Tell them that's you. You're a brave follower of Jesus. And so when we consider this then, what do we do? Do we just serve God when no one else is looking? You see, the world around us tries to keep the church inside the walls of the building. But God has designed us to come inside as often as we can, encourage ourselves, worship him, and go outside the walls of the building and live for Jesus in the workplace, in the neighborhood, wherever we find ourselves, to live transparently there so that we are an example to others. In fact, we should even abstain from the appearance of evil. Some people are. I remember one time I was renting a car here in Brampton when we needed two vehicles, and I went to rent it, and the rental place said, yeah, we'll give you a drive back. Here, this young lady's going to drive you back, and I said, no, I'll wait for a young man. Because I will not drive with a woman other than my wife in the car alone. Because when people see Pastor driving in the car with some lady, they just may get the wrong idea, say the wrong thing. So we make decisions because we want to serve God and we want to do it with all of our heart. And we need to be brave to make those decisions because other people don't always understand. Is that true? So we stand up for God. We live for Him. Now, lesson number three. God looks for people of faith. Say that word. Faith. God looks for people of faith who be brave enough to obey Him even when they don't totally understand everything. So we need to have faith. Faith is believing that God is someone, that He's alive today, He's active today, and that He has our best interest in mind. He only wants good for us. He thinks good thoughts about us. And God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we may ask or even think of Him. That God wants to bless us. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. So God wants us to have faith. How do we get faith? Faith comes from hearing. Hearing from the Word of God. It's hearing what God says about us, what God says about Himself, what God says about sin, what God says about living in a righteous way, where we consider ourselves dead to sin, but alive unto God, Romans 6:11. That we actually express our love to God day by day. We don't wait till Sunday and become a Sunday Christian, or even beyond that, a C&E Christian for Christmas and Easter. But we worship Him all the time. So let me elaborate on this then. Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. Now think of this man, Noah. He was building something he'd never seen before. He was given rough instructions from God and had to go ahead and do it. And then it was a big job. The workforce was small. Others were taunting him, were calling them names, were saying how foolish they were. They'd never been a flood before. There'd never been rain before. It was beyond his natural comprehension. But he was brave to stand up in his generation. And there was a price to it. We must be brave to stand up against the prevailing thoughts of our generation, the lifestyle presentation of our generation. We must be brave and courageous and stand up for righteousness. Stand up for what God says is right. And not just do it on a Sunday inside a building, but do it all week long outside the building, outside our home, in the community around us. And then we must be brave. We talked about faith. Faith never fails. It never quits. So to be brave, we have to be brave to continue doing what God said do. What if they would have built the ark only halfway because it took a long time? There was only 4 men working. And it was an enormous task. If we had 4 men building this building, how long would it have taken? We had a much larger crew with powered equipment and all the rest of it and trucks bringing stuff in. They had 4 men. And they had to cut the trees down themselves and hew the logs and bring them into place and everything themselves without any modern equipment, no power tools or anything. How long did it take them? Some think it took them 100 years to build the ark. Because it says Noah was 500 before they began, and now he's 600 when it's finished. So it took an enormous amount of time. What if they would have quit halfway through? Could you imagine the ark with one end and the other end open? And now the rain comes, what would happen? Everything. It would totally be gone. And so we have to remember, when God gives us a task, He wants us to continue all the way to the end, to be brave enough to never quit until we're finished. To always remember, God wants to work completely in us, not do part jobs. Sometimes we're great starters. Noah was more than a great starter. He finished. And you can finish your race as well. Lesson number 4. God will bring salvation and protection through his brave followers. Did you catch that? What did he do through Noah? He brought salvation to his family. It doesn't say his boys were chosen by God and walked with God. It says he was. He was the one. But his influence touched his family first and brought them into the ark of safety and influenced the others around. Others would mock him and push him away, but he did not allow the influence of others to turn him away from God's plan for his life. Is that a lesson we can learn? Absolutely. It doesn't matter whether it's people close to you or not. But understand, you are here for purpose. His purpose was not just to save his own life, but to save the life of all of us. Because if everybody else died, there wouldn't have been any more babies. And so God brought them in, saved his family, saved two of the animals, male and female, so that we can have all the animals around. God used him to bring salvation and protection. He needs us. He's called you. He's called us together to be brave in this generation, to understand that God has a message inside of us, a message of safety, salvation to those around us. Don't be hesitant to talk to people about their soul. Don't be hesitant to tell them that Jesus loves them, that there's one way to God. There's no other name under heaven by which man might be saved than the name Jesus Christ. Don't be hesitant about that. Don't think you have to be politically correct. If Noah was politically correct, all the animals would have been dead. And so is his family. So stand up for what is right. We don't stand up for what is right by putting everyone else down. Noah did not push everyone else down and point to them and how much of sinners they were. Instead, he obeyed God and did what God said do. And so God has a message for us that we're called to bring salvation and we're to bring protection around us as well. So demonstrate God's love to those around you. Can you do that? Demonstrate his love in practical ways. And then live bravely in front of others. Live with courage in front of others. Do not compromise. Elbow your neighbor. Tell them, no compromise. No compromising. Brave believers worship God and sacrifice to him. That's what he did. As soon as they all got out of the ark and sent the animals on their way, he went and he took some of those animals, the ones that were meant for sacrifice, and he sacrificed them to God and burnt them on an altar to God, which in that day was the way they sacrificed. He took the little that he had, and he took much percentage-wise out of it to offer a sacrifice to the living God. God wants us to be brave the same way, to live our lives as a life of sacrifice, to not hold on to things and say, oh, I only have a little. I don't have quite enough as much as I think I'm going to need. No, trust God and live a life of sacrifice before him and expect that the promises will be lived out in your life. God is helping us to learn how to be brave today. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you so much for your hand upon our lives. Thank you for this wonderful example in a man named Noah who stood out from all others. Help us to stand up for Jesus in this generation. Help us to live strong and boldly declare the goodness of God shall come in the land of the living. It shall be now when your blessing is lived out. Help us to live up to the standard that you expect for us. Let us turn from sin each day. Let us order our mouth, our lips, our words in a way that pleases you. Let us encourage others to live for you. And Lord, if we find ourselves in a place separate from you, like all those others around in Noah's generation, let us never be scoffers, Lord. But help us to surrender to you. I feel today there may be some in this room or some watching over the internet that you're aware that you are not right with God. your name wouldn't have been there in the sixth chapter of Genesis saying that you walked with God, that God saw you and declared you as righteous. You know your name would not have been there. So today I believe that the opportunity is here for your name to be written in the book of life, for you to surrender your life to Jesus and make a difference in the lives of others. God wants to turn lives around here in Canada, in Brampton, wherever you are, not just in Dominican Republic. So I want to invite you today to surrender your life to Jesus. How many would be brave enough to say, Pastor, I know that I'm separate from God. I know I've never asked Jesus to be Lord of my life, but I want to today. I don't want to be separate. I don't want to be under the judgment of God. Friend, if that's your cry, if that's your desire, I want to pray for you. Would you just signify by slipping your hand up and waving to me? I'm just looking quickly. Maybe an usher can help me. Anybody there, just put your hand up, say, pray for me, Pastor. I want to surrender my life to Jesus. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, young man. I want to surrender my life to Jesus. This is real. We're portraying Bible stories that are not stories. They're real life things that happen. Let's pray together. Let's all pray together. Say, Heavenly Father, just write out loud. Pretend nobody's around you. Or be bold, be brave. You don't care. Just say, Heavenly Father, I ask you to forgive me for sin in my life. Say it out loud, please. Change me from the inside out. Make me a brand new person. I receive you, Jesus, as the Lord of my life. I will live for you from this day forward. Help me every day to serve you so that God is pleased with my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. Praise God. Would you grab your connection card? It was mentioned earlier. On the back, there's some next steps. Praise God. And it talks about committing the Bible to memory. Just that one verse. Noah walked with God. He was righteous in his generation. Why do I say memorize that? So that you can see yourself. Put yourself in there instead of Noah. And see yourself as right before God. And then set a godly example for others to follow. Obey God even when it doesn't make sense. It didn't make sense to build a boat when there was no water. But God had a plan. And then give thanks to God in every situation. And if you accepted Jesus, over the right side it says, I'm interested in accepting Jesus as Lord or rededicating my life or being water baptized. And then please pray for the DR team while they're on their way, while they're in Dominican. When you leave this place today, I want you to finish filling this out. There's a little survey card and your connection card and drop them in the bucket. There'll be somebody at each of the exits. You know, earlier when we were talking about Dominican Republic and about doing things there and touching people's lives, I'd like us to take a little money with us to bless our missionaries there in the good work they're doing as well. And so if you want to be part of that, our giving kiosks are open. You can go on your smartphone and you can give that way as well at the website. Or you can, I see Jill coming. She may have another idea how to do that. But we just want to bless them for the great work they're doing and helping us.
I just wanted to say, if you want to know what's happening during the week, you can become my friend on Facebook, and we'll be posting pictures. Or you can download an app called Periscope. It's free, and we'll be posting little videos of the teams as they're out on the streets and different things. And you can just go on your phone or your computer, and you can watch what they're actually doing. And I know it would encourage your heart, and you would be blessed to see what's going on.
So that'll be before next Sunday. I fly over there. Jill flies out on Thursday. Team is on Friday. So they'll be start posting Friday night. And then I'll be down there ahead of the team, preaching in a number of churches, encouraging pastors, and setting things up as well. So thank you for praying for us. Remember this week, we had a great kickoff to the summer with our sports camps. We had 20 children here, and they were absolutely tired at the end of the day. The parents were thrilled. They went home and slept at night, and they had a great time. In fact, some of them, one of them, the mom came to pick up their daughter, and she, no, I'm not ready to go yet. I want to stay here. I just want to stay and still have more fun. So because of that, that's why we clean out the chairs. Okay, that's why we stack the chairs. That's why we remove the stage. That's why we do this each week. And so I want to especially thank the men that stay behind and do that. But we could use others. And many of our young guys, teenagers, and 20-year-olds, you are muscled out because God has made you that way so that you can serve and help people. So we don't let the ladies move the chairs around because we believe that they are very special vessels God has given that are more fragile than the men, even though some of you could punch the lights out of the men. But we understand that that's our paradigm here. So we don't want any ladies hurting themselves. We don't want men either. But every week, that's why we do it, is so that through the week, we make use of this building. So thank you for helping us stay behind. Don't just stand around and chat. You know, chat while you're stacking chairs, gentlemen. And ladies, if your husband runs out the door, send him back. In Jesus' name. Stand up, please. Let me bless you. First-timers, please come over to our Welcome Center. There's a gift there for you. We don't want to miss you. Father, I pray your blessing upon each and everyone in this place, those watching over the internet as well. We pray, Lord, that you'd keep us in the very center of your will throughout this week. Let your angels be around about us, keeping us safe and healthy, out of harm's way. Lord, bless your people as they go. Let them be missionaries, everyone, not just the team to DR, but every one of us missionaries into the society around us in Jesus' name. God bless you. Thank you.